So I continue. So did you like the first part? Was it okay? Yeah. I am also part of the activation team of Alert Online. Alert Online is a campaign organized by Ministry of Justice and Security. And what we do, and we is a part of Omnicom Public Relations Group. That's an PR agency who is running the campaign for the ministry. And this was a public tender, and that means that for 3 years, the public relations group runs the campaign. So the campaign exists starting 2012 already. And if we compare with the past, the biggest change we have made in 2017 is to include children, parents, and teachers in the surveys. And that's not, again, as said before the break, it is not representing, because we surveyed two less children, but we want to make it as representative as possible. But the rest of the figures, like that 51% of all Dutch people who were confronted with a part of cybercrime didn't change their behavior after it happened. And then you can think, you know, how can it be? And I think many of the times we focus on the negative parts of the internet. And I think we only should talk about the positive parts of the internet. So also the cybersecurity, I believe we need to make cybersecurity very positive. So a journalist called me from the Dutch broadcast station when we published the results, and we published the results every month, the cybersecurity month, it's a European cybersecurity month in October. We published the results, and the journalist asked me, Mr. Koudijk, what's your reaction on that 51% doesn't do, or 53% doesn't do anything? So I said, basically, that's a wrong question. I would like to talk what 47% does. And what we use is often in companies and organizations only the negative stuff. Yeah? So I'm really a positive guy, eh? Positive Eric Jan, eh? I said in the introduction. So I, even if only 2% of an organization does something positive, I don't talk about the 98. But I try to move the playground and try to see what can we learn of that 2%. Now, basically what we said as an activation team, we need to go for cybersecurity heroes. So, and our main goal is to come up with a generation cybersecure, probably in 2022. But we need to have a common understanding that what we have learned, for example, in traffic campaigns, you need to finish your seatbelt, don't drink if you have to drive. We need to learn from those types of campaigns because they worked. And there was invested a lot of energy and money, and especially scientists about behavior. We need to include them in the discussion. How do we want to get people changing passwords? And probably it's not needed anymore because we have other tricks. It's not necessary to use passwords nowadays. I will give you a tip at the end of the presentation. So basically what we do is we are generating differentiating content, meaning that we don't buy TV ads, we don't buy radio ads, but we invest in interviewing youngsters about what they do, share it, ask our partners to share it. So a very big focus area of Alert Online is to create partnerships. Currently, we have more than 300 partnerships. And partnership means that you can you don't have to pay for it because it's from the government. But it means that if you sign our forms, it's not a legal contract, but it's just an intention that's very important, then you promise to focus on cybersecurity awareness. And we are creating content like flyers with tips in English and in Dutch, so it can be used in international companies in the Netherlands, all that kind of stuff. Because most of the marketing departments and communication departments, they don't have time for it because it's not about their product, but it's about cybersecurity, and that's not important. Some of the discussions I'm currently involved in with the larger companies is that I'm a strong believer that cybersecurity should be owned by HR. It should be strategically owned by human resources because it's part of the talent development of an individual. And if an individual is not really cyber savvy, probably he should apply for another job. So we need to move the playground and focus on what we already learned in behavior of people. Yeah? So the content, we launched the content in Facebook, in Snapchat, all kinds of stuff, and we focus specifically on influencers. So what we have done is we, for example, work together with Isabel. That's a girl who was in the finals of the song contest, and she has a huge impact on Instagram. And what we do is we reach specific audiences via Instagram, but not with the same messages, because many campaigns, they're just copying a message. That doesn't work. So they are placing the same message on Facebook, the same message on Snapchat, and all the Snapchat users think, you know, boring content, all those boring ads, I don't believe it. So basically, you can better not advertise on the wrong way than advertise. Because if you advertise in the wrong way, you get an opposite reaction of the target audience. Huh? Ever thought about that? So the right guy, I know him for quite a long time, is police guy. He's working for the Dutch police. He's called Jan Willem, and he is very customer-centric. So the citizens of a specific city, he see it as his customers. So they organize 2 times a year an event together with the citizens, and one of the mothers asked him, you know, why is the police not joining YouTube? And I will explain you YouTube. YouTube is the second largest search engine in the world. Yeah? How do companies use YouTube? They hire a video company, they pay a lot of money, they do very, very interesting company movie, and then they launch the movie, and then 500 people are watching the movie and they're happy. And my twins, they are creating very, very simple movie. 1,500 people are watching, nobody pays, because it's out of their enthusiasm. So what we should do is we should find employees who automatically are enthusiastic about their thing. And a policeman is enthusiastic about his work, right? So we don't need a communication agency creating campaigns which cost huge amount of money. And the communication department is approving and delaying. And at the end, when the content is ready, it's old content, right? Recognizable? So that's the reason why influencers work. So we need to, let's say, from a communication perspective, look at some borders. So what he is doing currently, in these days, very special moment, Netherlands has 17 million citizens. 200,000 subscribers he has on his YouTube channel. Every movie, every vlog he made is shown to between a minimum of 50,000 unique YouTube watchers, but some of them 1.8 million. Yeah? So a Dutch TV program, they're very happy, is 400,000 people are watching to the TV program, and he makes a vlog, and 1.4 million people are watching. That's the reason. One of the reasons we have decided with the Allied Online campaign to ignore TV. Yeah, it's a waste of money. So if we look to the speciality of Isabel, she's a young talent who likes to sing, and her movies, 1.1 million views, and so it's the same comparable impact on the YouTube platform. So we said we focus on video, and we use the videos primarily on the social media channels watched by and used by our target audiences. Target audience are vital industry, a police guy, a young girl, vital industry, energy companies and so. Yes, because they have all children. And what we try to do is we try to start a discussion at home. So, Daddy, why are you never changing your passwords? Why, Daddy, why aren't you using a password manager? Because I looked at Isabel, and she's doing that. And you're working for a company who is at the stock exchange, and you're behaving like that? That's the discussion what we try to do. Because we firmly believe, and this is my personal belief, we need to enter the home. Because if somebody protects her or his own family, automatically you will behave like that on the working place, right? So what we try to do is we try to change all the things at the working place. But in the past, you know, you called the help desk, the ICT department, and they said, yeah, switch off your computer. Yes. Wait a minute. Yes. Switch it on. Recognizable? Therefore, we don't trust the ICT department. And now we are having the same discussion again. So we should make it fun, right? Now, and the media, Dutch media, they like the campaign. So what we did do is at Schiphol Airport, we tried to challenge a little bit. At Schiphol Airport, after customs, we organized a party. And the party was for group 8 children, so 11 and 12 year old. And they had to answer all kinds of cybersecurity questions. And if they had the right answer, the police flogger, and by the way, he's very popular in the Netherlands. So what happened at the ministry is that in the beginning when we were discussing the campaign, some of the people of the ministry, they didn't know the police flogger. So I said, ask at home. Daddy, you're working with Jan Willem. That's cool. That's cool. So they liked Daddy's work. He's working at the government and don't know what he really does. But if you are working with a police vlogger, this is really cool, you know? And that's how humans work. And media like it. So what we do, we made videos with her about how to change passwords. We even interviewed the CEO of Google Netherlands because we said, yeah, basically you as CEO, you are responsible that we are visiting fake sites. So Isabel started interviewing the CEO, and he agreed. It is very, very unique. So he agreed, and we had to comply to some terms, of course. But we ask vendors to tell the story. And this is content we make. So we have, this is a guy who is a scientist in behavior. So he is explaining, Isabel, you know, why don't we change your behavior, and why doesn't it work? So I can explain it why it doesn't work. It's very easy. And we have chosen a behavioral scientist who doesn't know anything of cybersecurity because I want to have somebody who asks the right questions. And we can focus on the specialists on social behavior, but you know, there is a reason why it doesn't work, right? So I think we should, and he's specialized in food. Cool, huh? Food and energy. Remco is a guy, the password specialist. We have a great... Renko Pijpers, he's specialist in communication with children of Mijn Kind Online. It's part of KennisNet. It's probably you can elaborate on that a little bit. I don't know. Yeah. Later. And what she does is this, is Google Netherlands, and also about banking. So a lot of people think banking is not safe. Mobile banking app is not safe, but it's really safe. You know, it's safer than desktop. So that means that if we make content for the youngsters, they can explain again to their parents that it's safe. And we did it. Now, and in the middle, I love it the most. More than 2 million views on Facebook. The Ethical Hacker, a well-known guy in the Netherlands, one of our partners, really good guy, looks really like a hacker, you know, very smart guy. And they went to Amsterdam, and they were scanning people's smartphones and showing on an entertaining way and a non-difficult way why and how you are hacked in your smartphone without doing anything and what to do against it. Yeah. Now, and what worked, our customer asks, does it work? So then we show them just Facebook. This is proof. We don't need the research for that. If people like it, they share it. And on Facebook, some people working for banks, they said, you know, this is by far the best content, even better than our own communication department. And we said, you know, ask them to use the videos. It's all free. So we try to share, and make fun. Also our minister, Vert Grapperhaus, of Justice and Security is very happy. So this is an example we organized together with Shell. So Shell has a Generation Discover Festival each year. 35,000 visitors in the offline world. Not online, in the offline world. And they are working together with partners like the Dutch police, ABN AMRO. And we were able, we were very lucky as Alert Online, we were able to join this. And we had only one goal. Be a part of the Youth Journal. The Youth Journal in the Netherlands is one of the most watched channels by all children. Not at the moment it's broadcasted on TV, but the day after in the classroom. And we made a video about fake news. So we made games about how do you recognize fake news. That's not really cybersecurity, but we helped them. And of course, Isabel was performing over there. We said, you know, Isabel, you can see her, she will perform. And everybody happy. It was really, really cool stuff. And then a journalist of the Youth Journal said, now we will make a movie of it. 3:10, prime channel television opening. We were very happy about it. So the findings, more of the findings, and I will leave the sheet for a second after all the bullets are on the sheet so you can make a picture of it. 81% asks parents if Wi-Fi is present at the holiday location. So meaning if the camping doesn't have a Wi-Fi, you will have really a nightmare in your car. Recognizable? Yeah. And I was discussing these things with Mary Jo, and Mary Jo said, Eric Jan, you forgot a very important word, and she's right. High quality Wi-Fi. Yeah? So not Wi-Fi, high quality Wi-Fi. They need to prove that it's at least able to stream video. Huh? They pay less and less attention to the security of public Wi-Fi. So we have an increase of less attention. That's worrying, right? So in 2017, they were more aware, and it seems that they are starting to be less aware. And that's logical, because 40% use Wi-Fi if they're not at home, because they don't have big data plans, and they have Wi-Fi at home, and I try to find Wi-Fi everywhere. 32% know how to see if a website is secure. 16% recognize fake websites. If I recall correctly, 10% you said in your research, right? In the research in Bulgaria, was about 10% who would recognize it. Eh? Yeah, something like fake. I would have to check, it's interesting. But this is worrying, right? Because a lot doesn't recognize. 35% use the same password. 25% change passwords. And 33% use different passwords. That's the outcome of the survey. And children like to connect to people they actually don't know. Actually, one of the youngsters in the beginning of this conference told it herself. How do I know that guy or girl is real? That means I like to connect. 74%. 20% may use the business laptop of one of their parents. 15% use of the business smartphone. And this is what we wanted to research, because we said in our team, and we have all children, we are in the cybersecurity space, no way that they may use my laptop. But if you don't know, and we researched, it's quite a lot. And 30% say they worry about criminals on the internet. So they are aware that the internet is dangerous. And many children talk with their parents about internet security. That were some of the findings I really would like to share in this part of the presentation. And what I will do now is show you a print screen of the total research. It's 55 pages, which I will distribute so you can also get it as a PDF file. And just take it and put it in Google Translate, because it's Dutch. But these kind of graphs we have. And my parents always talk with me about the dangers on the internet of social media. On school, we get lessons about what you need and not need to do on the internet. I never do dangerous things online. Those kinds of questions we asked the children. So I think Mary Jo will continue. And after that, we have an interactive session with all of us, where we are creating tech clouds live.
I wanted to just switch back to one picture to start with, and then I will show you my presentation.
Because the funniest thing is, you showed this picture earlier.
Yeah.
And to be honest, for all of us, even though Holland is a small country, we just met yesterday for the first time. So we had a lovely dinner with Jordan, and afterwards we went somewhere to a bar where we had some drinks.
Very late.
And because we are both so happy about all of the things we do and so excited, at the end of the bar, a guy was screaming, "You must be Dutch," because we're overexcited telling all the things we wanted to tell and share with the people in Bulgaria. But for some reason, we shared so much, but we forgot something. So I just wanted to point out this guy here on the left-hand side,
Samedi
Doan. I will tell you a story about the cyber workplace. Savadi Doan is one of the young people from Holland who sent me an email, I think a year and a half ago, telling me about how he thinks the system, the educational system in Holland, flunks. So he asked for a solution, and I will show it in my presentation. Called the cyber workplace. It used to be a Dutch name, but I don't think you all know, don't know how to pronounce cyberwerkplaats abroad, so we just translated into cyber workplace. So what happened? Me, left-hand side, and Anouk Vos, my partner, associate partner, we met at 2011, where the two of us were hired by the National Cybersecurity Center. While we were there, I was hired there for about 3 years. I had all of these findings, and ever since I can remember, there's one thing I really like to do, and that's change the world, the digital world, and change it to a safe place. So every minute we ever worked together, we were just creating opportunities, trying to make the world safer, come up with ideas. So in Holland, people call us the twins. Even though we're not alike, we kind of like to be both a rebel with a cause. So I wanted to come up with a title. So how would I, you know, introduce myself, tell you about all of the awards I won, or being called the one of the 100 influencers in Holland for 2018, which is very cool. But at the end, I'm famous for being a rebel with a cause, and I will tell you about all of the rebellion things I've done in Holland. So what is the problem? So how did I come up with the cyber workplace? I use social media, only LinkedIn. I'm not on Facebook, I'm not on Twitter. You know, I have an opinion about that, but I'll keep it to myself. But people follow me on LinkedIn and even send me messages. I like what you do, or can you come and teach us, or can you come to my university and talk to my teachers? Because if I have an opinion about something, I intend to spread out the world and hope to make the world a better place. So I was hired by several companies in Holland for the last years, and one of them, I will not name, will not call their name, they asked me, can you find and point out the cybersecurity talent? Because all around the world, everybody knows there's a really, we call it the war on talent. A lot of people need cybersecurity talent. So a lot of companies told me, there is no talent. There are no people who want to be involved in cybersecurity on the one hand. And on the other hand, I received a lot of messages from youngsters telling me, I really need a job. I can't find the people who need people with specific certifications or specific skills. And that frustrated me. So I thought there must be an answer or a solution to this problem. So I came up with a cyber workplace where all of the people were tossed into a pool, a talent pool, and employers who said, we can't find any talent, we showed them the talent, such as Zawadi, the guy from the picture you just saw. So kind of a slow. Ever in Holland, you know, the employers who told me, I can't find talent, show me the talent, I'm paying you to show me the talent, they were all upset and all angry, so I asked them, well, let me check your job description. What do you need from the people? What are you asking? So if you have a look at everything that's published, they're all looking for people with university degrees, or PhD in cyber or technology innovation, or as you can tell, 7 years of related work experience. Well, to be honest, most of the hackers I've worked with in the world, the best, even Edwin van Andel, as you saw in the picture, they don't have any education at all. I see you nodding. You recognize it? Yeah. So how come on the one hand we say we need some talent, and I can't find talent, and on the other hand, the best hackers in the world don't have any education at all? So I thought, you know, we should do something with it. So, at the cyber workplace, we invited specific people to come and join us, such as dropouts. I know a lot of dropouts, and Zawadi is one of them. He goes to a specific school in Holland. But in order to get his diploma, he also needs to learn about philosophy, How many layers does the earth concern? I have no clue. Some, I have learned it somewhere, but I forgot all about it because I think it's not important. I see you nodding. You learn all about the stuff. You don't have any clue what to do with it. So when we were having drinks last night, we were talking about German language. In Holland, you need to learn German language. Still know how to talk in German? Me neither. But we have a diploma that says know how to talk in German. Maybe three words, but that's all about it. So we have dropouts. We have gamers. So the people who are very good at Fortnite or other specific games, we have learned through the process that gamers are very good to be forensic experts. So in Holland, we work with, as we called, hobby bobbies, like police officers, and they walk through the area, and whenever they see a kid who is very addictive and is only gaming 24 hours a day, he will ring his doorbell and ask the kid, have you ever heard of the cyber workplace? The cyber workplace, by the way, is only in Rotterdam, so it's not that we have hobby bobbies walking all around Holland, it's only Rotterdam. So we get a lot of gamers, and to be honest, absolutely most of the gamers with no certification or no degree were hired by the top Dutch organizations and turned into the best forensics. So we just, you know, got a basement, got some kids, made sure we got some money, and we just started it. And this is what I wanted to say with being a rebel without a cause. I used to work in The Hague. The Hague is the main capital for ministries, Hague Security Delta, I don't know, they call it the City of Peace, Justice and Security. And I came up with this plan to create a cyber workplace. But because everyone was so focused on we need a solution, but we need a solution that we can rely on or that we know or we can trust. So everyone in Holland, including all of the municipality of The Hague, declined the cyber workplace. So I thought, you know what, I go to Rotterdam, it's a better city anyhow, and we'll make it fly anyhow. So we have the dropouts, online rascals, students and gamers. Also, if people or youngsters in Holland are sentenced to jail or come out of jail, they also find a place at the cyber workplace, not to scare or to scare other students, but to show them what they've learned or how did they become a victim of something. Because in Holland, for example, with Fortnite, you can get money out of the game by kind of do illegal stuff. But in Holland, people are not intent to believe where the good cause ends and the bad things begin. So every student who joins the cyber workplace, first day, first minute, first hour, is a lesson in law. What does it mean? When do you go from gray to black area? What does it mean when you're sentenced to jail? And we have the proof of concept because we have, people who went to jail and they will scare the hell out of them so they will not cross the line. In a nice way, by the way. So a little bit about the cyber workplace in Holland. We kind of lent the idea from Paris. There's a school called École 42, School 42. It's a concept. We teach the kids, and this is kind of our motto, hack until you crack. So the first pilot week we ever created, we asked all of the kids to breach something, but it was all legal. And the kids who were able to hack systems and get into stuff, they were all offered jobs. So the people who will come in, it's free of charge, no tuition. We have guest lectures. So every Friday, for example, we have people from sea police or people from State Department or even a former felon who did stuff to tell the kids about what have they done, how can they learn. We even build an Internet of Things corner and try to breach all of the Internet of Things. So we do a lot of things, but I think the best part of the cyber workplace are our internships. So our employers are able to get a student without any payment and get to know each other and see if they are what they are looking for. They don't need to pay us because it's all not for profit. I'm not getting any money out of it, but we just want to make sure that the employers will meet the talents of the future, because the employers still are keep on hanging. We need PhD and bachelor's degrees. So the one thing that's important to know about the cyber workplace, we don't have accredited diplomas. People get certifications, but they're not official certifications in Holland. But because most of the youngsters who come, they don't want to go to school anymore. They don't want to learn about the amount of layers the earth contains, etc. They feel very proud of earning just one certificate. Also the gamers who just, you know, sit on their bed and play games, this is the one thing they achieved in a long period. So most of them are very proud of the certificate, put it on social media, telling everyone, look, I got a certificate from Cyber Workplace. And at the end, we started off with one cyber workplace. You know, as I told you at the beginning, everyone was laughing about the cyber workplace. But I'll tell you something, what happened? This is the first pilot week in 2017. We had no money. We just threw in some of our own money because we wanted to show the world that we knew what we're doing. So we founded the first pilot week, and we sent on social media the message, if you want to be part of the first pilot week, send me a message, but you will be part of a selection period, because we need to know if you're really into it and if you're really motivated. Because at the cyber workplace, it is come as you are. If you're not motivated, you cannot come. We don't want people hanging around being miserable and, you know, make other people feel miserable. So the one thing we ask, give me your motivation. And we put it online on a Tuesday at 11 o'clock, because social studies learned in Holland, if you want to reach a mass amount of people, Tuesday morning, 11 o'clock is the best time to do so. So we put it online, and within one day, we had 2,000 applications. 2,000. We only had place for 12. So the first point was made, was like, okay, so everybody thought it was a bad idea. You see, we put it online, and within a day, 2,000 applications. So we got 12 out of them. Savedi was one of them. He's also here on the picture. You see, part of the first group. And we were asked to do nice things, such as hack the harbor in Rotterdam, and do other stuff. So there's also a robot on the right-hand side. We were asked to hack a robot, etc., etc. And what happened? I have all of the email addresses of Dutch journalists, radio makers, etc. So I thought, you know, I will just send them a message. Come and have a look with your own eyes. And what happened is that I did, I think, about 30 interviews, television. It was all over, even 8 o'clock primetime news. Because all of a sudden it was, oh yeah, we need talent, but there is no talent. And I showed the world, at least Holland, there's talent everywhere, but you need to look in a different way. So this is the first pilot week. And as I said, we started off with no money. I tossed in money of myself. Anouk Vos, my associate partner, tossed in her own money. So we did this in our own time, free time, own money, own energy. We didn't earn any penny. Still don't earn any money out of this project, sorry. So let's talk numbers. Rotterdam, this is Rotterdam. We started with the first one in Rotterdam over there. And within, I think, a week after the pilot, because we were everywhere in every newspaper, every talk show, all of a sudden, a lot of companies thought, oh, cyber workplace, that's a nice idea. Even the municipality and the Ministry of Justice thought, maybe we should have a cyber workplace. But we think cyber workplace is a great initiative, because we have no interference whatsoever from ministers, departments, municipalities, majors. You know, it's our decision. We make up the rules. And if you like it, you like it, you can come, but we don't want any interference. So we declined all of the offers. And then at a certain moment, we were asked to come up with a second cyber workplace in a province called Friesland. It's a province well known for Wat kan je als enige doen in Friesland? There's just one thing you can do in Friesland. Exactly, there's just one thing you can do in Friesland. Sailing. Or skating. Yeah, if it's frozen. But the young kids over there, they felt neglected. They said, if we don't want to sail, what else can we do? So we founded a second cyber workplace in Friesland. And now at the end, we got a lot of cities asking us to do the same, such as Amsterdam, Utrecht, sorry for the Dutch word, it's a city, center of the country. And we even got in contact with the American embassy, and I tell you, and I'll show you a movie from 3 minutes to tell you what happened in America. So my associate and I, as I told you, we are twins, or people intend to call us twins, because we both were asked to be part of an international visitors leadership program sponsored by the American State Department. So we went to America in 2017, just when we found the cyber workplace, and we start talking about the cyber workplace, how we founded it, how do we think we can attract more youngsters, et cetera, et cetera. So when we returned from America, all of a sudden we got a message from the American embassy in Holland asking us if we'd like to start a cyber workplace in America. There's a specific target audience in America that wanted to get involved, and they're American native Indians. So we got some money, and we did not really found the cyber workplace, but we got the people from America here for a week. And I will show you in a clip that will last about 3 minutes what happened when the Americans come. I think I need to press something here, sorry. Dus moet een. Is een play. Oh, hier, sorry, I think. Oh no. That's your.
Is it in the next one?
It's in the, yeah, it's, I think so. Maybe we can try. Yeah. Oh, yeah, I hide it in the slide. Even if we don't have sound, the words will tell the story. It will last 3 minutes. So we now have a cyber workplace in America. I just wanted to tell you something about the numbers. We had about 400 students in 2 years, all without diplomas, all game addicted, some felonies. Everything happened, everything crossed our path. 80%, 80, found a paid day job without diplomas, without the right certification. So for us, the cyber workplace is a concept of proof that being a rebel with a cause could at the end work. So when I was asked to tell something about the cyber workplace, I thought maybe in Bulgaria is the next country to get a cyber workplace. So I have some questions for you to answer to see if cyber workplace could be, Bulgaria could be the next country to build a cyber workplace. So my first question to you, diplomas are old school. InfoSec cannot be taught, sorry for the misspelling by the way, at school because teachers don't know how to keep up. Anyone who wants to respond? I see some students diving away. Anyone? No. Teachers? About the teachers? Okay. I will just finish with the most relevant question for today. Cyber workplace would never work in Bulgaria. Would, wouldn't, agree, disagree? Is there a mic or? Yeah, I wanna give it to you, yeah. You say disagree, can you explain it?
The best place for your next project.
The best?
Yeah.
All right.
we were speaking about the young generation and their skills in the know-how in the technology. So I think that it would work, definitely.
And is there something else, as you've seen from the presentation, that you think that would not appeal to imagination here in Bulgaria, something I must do differently? Or if you see it, you think it will just work as it is? Yeah, I'm not sure if it's on. Yeah. It looks nice though. Yeah, leave it. All right, yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, just leave. Thank you. Spread the news. Thank you. Anyone who would like to comment? Yeah, I just wanted to hand you the mic, but it's not working, so maybe you can just stand up. All right, sorry.
Is it?
Yeah!
Yay, victory. It's a high tech. So if considering the cyber workplace concept, if you scrub the universities, actually in Bulgaria there is not that many places you could develop yourself in ethical hacking, white hat hacking or whatever. Actually, Exactly, I would agree with the young lady at the end that Bulgaria is the place to try this initiative. This is what we discussed with my colleague briefly. Just there are too many people that can develop themselves, but are lacking the place, certain leadership, certain guidance, and just a couple of tools, or at least a great place where to start. And well, yeah, if somebody can tell me a good place where you can learn this in Bulgaria, I will be appreciating
it. I know where to find you. Anyone who likes to respond or comment? Valentina. For reasons.
So my opinion is that I strongly disagree with the statement that it couldn't work in Bulgaria. Because we have a lot of good ethical hackers, a lot of good pen testers, a lot of good specialists in the cybersecurity field. The problem is that they're forced to work for foreign companies, because in Bulgaria, the problem is not that we don't have experts. The problem is that we don't have interest in cybersecurity all over. The companies are still neglecting that. The government is also doing that. I mean, there are investments, but a general interest is lacking. And I believe that with this kind of a cyber workplace, some things can change.
Hopefully. Thank you. Sure.
My name is Velko Ivanov. I'm from European Movement Bulgaria, and my opinion is that it depends on the legal environment. It's an obstacle, because if you see the major institutions, they didn't take care, or just they run a public errand and they didn't get qualified companies to protect their sites. So people, they just, as the lady before speaking before me said, it's not a matter of having expertise and qualified experts. Just they are not; they don't feel their expertise is needed by the institutions.
Yeah.
So it is. It's not a matter of let's say willingness, but the institutions, they just cannot create the environment. And people just they feel excluded, then they're not needed, so they just go to commercial sector, to where they could just give proof of their expertise and get the proper remuneration. Yeah. So you cannot just say that if something, whether there is a place for that or not, whether it would work, because nobody asks question whether this is appropriate and whether they need it, since there's no such a question, and there's no demand. How can you ask for supply?
Fair enough. Absolutely.
The other thing I believe is an obstacle in Bulgaria is that we don't have, I have to explain it, responsible disclosure policies. So, I don't know.
Everyone is aware of responsible disclosure? Do I need to explain it? Anyone?
Okay. So that means that when you discover a hack, when you're pen testing, that means that you're protected. Like the whistleblowers, it's the same. So you have an organization or an association or the government itself protects you when you deliver such kind of information. For example, you're a hacker, and you try to see if, for example, Bennett is secure. So you hack them, mm-hmm. but then you deliver the results and say, hey, you have vulnerabilities here and there. But but all the media would hear is, we hacked you.
Yeah.
So they're gonna sue you.
Yeah.
And that's the problem. We don't do it here. We search foreign companies to do it for them, because in Bulgaria there's no field for that.
Yeah, so it's also a nice way of telling we need responsible disclosure as a Bulgarian country.
Thank you, Mary J. I would agree and I would disagree. I would disagree in the sense that if done in Bulgaria, it might be done in a different way, might be better. Even, let's hope so. But disagree. Which one was agree, which was disagree? Anyway, both ways. Something like that would work in Bulgaria, just given the experience that we already had with similar initiatives and even hackathons that's been organized with support of the government and the campaigns that started from the government. I was planning to talk about that. It's We Won't Be Hacked in translation, which became a solid campaign, reached almost 5,000 children.
Wow.
Teaching them how to create their passwords and you know, such kind of techniques and advices, recommendations how to do in the cyberspace. And it was pretty successful. And it was almost the same style. You know, involve them, attract them,
yeah.
make it as a show for them, and let them play with that. So there is room for that, but that's a really interesting idea. And I would like we kind of join forces. You come very often to Bulgaria now.
Yeah.
So
maybe that's
the
a
next
signal,
time
right?
We can
yeah.
establish something like that. All right.
Thank Let's you. Do so. Thank you. Well, I don't want to waste any of your time anymore. Thank you all for contributing, and thank you for hearing me out.
Можем ли да сме сигурни за личните си данни, споделени в мрежата, как да сме сигурни, че всичко, което споделяме в защитени пространства в мрежата, действително е защитено? И не само това. Очакваме да чуем от Красимир Симонски, заместник-председател на Агенцията за електронно управление. Заповядайте. Така ще ви дам микрофон. Работи.
Работи, да. Благодаря. Благодаря най-напред на организаторите за избора на темата. Когато става въпрос за децата, приоритетите са винаги топ приоритети и тази тема няма как да ни избяга от вниманието и да ни обърнем необходимото внимание. От името на държавата в случая, Държавна агенция електронно управление, искам да поздравя организаторите, а в същото време и гостите, които дойдоха от Холандия да ни разкажат за тези чудесни инициативи и то с такава енергия и ентусиазъм, толкова заразително. И това абсолютно, както казах и преди, е стила, с който можем да се обръщаме към децата и да ги привличаме. Аз, докато говореше Мери Джо и Ерик така ентусиазирано за тези неща, си опитах да представя нали, децата в тази зала, да им покажем тези слайдове, нали, слайд след слайд, да им говорим и така нататък. Със сигурност няма да успеем да ги привлечем за тези цели. В този смисъл, чуто ми беше интересно да наблюдавам и изследването. Съгласен съм с голяма част от данните. Може би се различава с това, което ние успяхме да открием по време на кампанията, когато започвахме, няма да ме хакнат. Но изводите, определено се съгласяваме с тях и начините, по които можем да се обърнем към тези проблеми, те са доста. Но при всички положения трябва да се съобразиме с аудиторията. Тук се споменаха различни поколения. Аз съм почнал от Baby Boomers, моите деца са Millennials, съответно техните деца ще бъдат алфа поколението. И тук трябва да отчитаме спецификите на всяко едно от поколенията. Когато говорим за децата и учениците в конкретни случаи, напрека ние говорим за две поколения. Поколение ройство. И даже имаше един такъв случай на 16 годишен младеж, който беше направил така доста сериозни обири точно в Холандия, холандските банки, който не получи работа, доколкото разбрах в съответните служби, но го ползваха за консултант. Някои банки след това го наеха. Вие знаете за кой случай става въпрос. От гледна точка на държавата, това, което можем да направим и ние го правим, е първо цялостния поглед и отношение към киберсигурността. Както знаете, наскоро беше прият закона за киберсигурност, ноември, който дефинира организацията и въвежда доста сериозно киберхигиената като сериозно задължение на публичните институции и на съответните оператори на съществени услуги и критичните оператори. Т.е. как държавата може най-добре да се представи, да се предпази, използвайки киберхигиената. Това, което е установено и е факт, е, че ако Ако спазваме необходимата киберхигиена, общо взето 80% от атаките се спират само с мерки, които са свързани с киберхигиена. Добра парола, съответни конфигурации, точни в съответните устройства, самите потребители знаят как да си ползват и да си пазят паролите и така нататък. Това е нещото, което трябва да научим и нашите деца, като в същото време го направим един път по-атрактивно, втори път ефективно. Защото някой път е много досадно да въвеждаш една дълга парола и да въвеждаш няколко пъти на всяко влизане и така нататък. Тук вече трябва и технологично да потърсим и съответните начини, с двойна автентикация, подобни технологии, които позволяват максимално бързо с пръстови отпечатъци и други биометрики, да може децата бързо и лесно да ползват подобни защитни средства. След това споменах за кампанията «Няма да ме хакнат». Тук сигурно има интернет, може да пуснем сайта, ако успеете. Просто напишете «Няма да ме хакнат», аз не го знам точно, това ще е на нашата агенция. Много интересна кампания, която ние започнахме края на 2017 година, точно преди българското председателство. И всъщност по време на българското председателство тази кампания вървеше. Успяхме да стигнем до 5000 деца. Мария Габриел беше патрон на събитието. Имаме посланик, едно дете от Силистра, Ния, която стана посланик на кампанията. Но това, което мене ме впечатли в тази кампания, е точно този момент на запалването на децата по техния си детски начин, с игра, с атрактивни методи, да им се обясняваше, ето ги нашите аниматори, това са нашите колеги от агенцията, които се облекоха в тези бели дрехи и правеха постоянно едни такива шоута за децата, като те бяха с точно този обучителен ефект. В края на тези сесии децата наистина да излезат с разбирането как да се предпазват, какви са мерки могат да предприемат, и всичките тези неща се представяха пред тях в тази игрова форма. Много сме доволни от кампанията, потърсиха ни, Министерството на образованието се ангажира също и разработихме и курс за учениците, обучителен курс за киберсигурност, който да се преподава в училищата. Да, проблем е учителите да навлезат в тематиката и да бъдат адекватни на съответното съдържание и технологията най-вече. Даже аз бих казал обратно, децата биха научили учителите как да... Те самите да преподават. Нещо, което ви имате във вашия подход. Децата сами да открият и в същото време да дадат и своя принос към това, включително идеи, ако тръгнем от тези малки хакери, които през хакерството научават тънкостите на защитата. Много може да се говори по темата, определено, но при всички положения и подобни инициативи, както казах, ще бъдат подкрепени. Едно заради децата, едно заради изключително актуалната тема. Интензивността на киберсигурността като тематика, като приоритет постоянно нараства, може би всички я усещаме. Това, което се случи и в Европейския съюз, е много позитивно. От миналата година приоритета киберсигурност е един от върховите приоритети в речта на Юнкер, от петте неща, които бяха споменати така приоритетни в двете му речи последователни годишни, киберсигурността присъстваше като един от петте приоритета. И това се случи по време на нашето председателство. Даже едни важни нормативни документи бяха приети. Сега вече е прият и регламента за авторското право, който насочва до някъде и към подобни решения, свързани с децата. Съдържание, което е толкова да се контролира, колкото регулативни мерки, с които може да се подходи и към съдържанието, което е в интернет. С това да приключа и отново да благодаря на организаторите и на гостите и на всички, които участваха тук. Изключително така беше интересно да се чуе и тази интерактивната част, и да се въвлече и публиката, аудиторията в този разговор. Всички сме съпричастни, приоритет са ни децата, те са нашето бъдеще, така че мисля, че сме на прав път. Благодаря ви.
И аз благодаря много. Едно мнение от Държавната агенция за закрила на децата, Радиона Никова, заповядайте.
Приятно ми е аз да продължа, така да се каже, да представя какво прави държавата в тази посока. Просто бих искала да кажа няколко думи, не като въпроса, като по-скоро коментар и допълнение наистина. Първо да ви кажа, че към Държавната агенция за закрила на детето съществува един съвет на децата и част от присъстващите тук са запознати, имам предвид специално Надя и Явор Колев, който обаче, за съжаление, не може да остане до края, защото те са работили с този съвет на децата и всъщност ние сме приложили наистина метода връзници обучават връзници миналата година и преди това, защото този детски съвет съществува от 2003 година и периодически прави кампания за превенция, примерно, на опасности в интернет през годините, но миналата година беше особено успешна кампанията в цялата страна. Децата коментираха филма на Надя и имаше гости, осигурени от ГДБОП, които коментираха конкретни ситуации и как да им помогнат. Но аз бих искала да добавя две неща. Първо, по отношение също и на изследването, което е много интересно, но от една страна съм обнадеждена, че децата биха се обадили на държавни структури, казвате 28%, което е добре. От друга страна, бих ви помолила, като правите подобни проучвания, да включвате опции на кого от всички възможни случаи, т.е. от всички възможни варианти за сигнализиране биха използвали, защото това все още е. Това е още един метод за разпространение на нашата информация. Към агенцията съществува една безплатна денонощна телефонна линия 116-111, която е европейски номер всъщност за социални услуги и ние сме развили, за да можем да услужваме и сигнали, свързани с опасности в интернет, защото имаме сключено и споразумение с центъра на Георги Апостолов. Т.е. има добро изградено сътрудничество между държавата и неправителствения сектор. И едно последно нещо и приключвам. Миналата година обявихме един конкурс деца да разработят мобилни приложения, които да разпространяват информация как да се сигнализира всъщност за подобни случаи, в които деца се чувстват засегнати. И най-интересното е, че имаме разработено такова приложение, може да бъде открито на сайта на DAST. Беше с награди, с широка информационна кампания, защото чрез този конкурс идеята не беше само да получим крайния продукт, а да поговорим по темата още веднъж. И имаме победител, един младеж от Димитровград, който направи едно страхотно приложение. Чакаме да стане на 18 години, за да можем да го използваме и по всякакви други начини. Така че посетете и нашия сайт и мисля, че там има полезна информация. А иначе поздравления за форума и за интересните презентации. Благодаря.
Благодаря и аз. И понеже вървим към финал, господин Божилов, за заключителни думи, заповядайте.
Беше един доста напрегнат, но в същото време много активен, бих казал интерактивен ден с обмяна на идеи, добри практики. Аз се надявам, че днес поставихме начало на едно сътрудничество, което ще продължи. Много неща са направени, както разбрахме, на ниво правителствени органи, на ниво неправителствени организации. Много изследователи работят по темата. Важното е, че имаме разбиране за това, че трябва да подобрим системата за защита. Много интересни методи могат да бъдат приложени, особено по отношение на децата, така че те чрез игра, чрез взаимодействие с възрастните, да могат да навлязат по-лесно и по-правилно в този свят на интернет и на новите технологии. А иначе Софийски форум за сигурност продължава с своите инициативи. Можете да ни намерите в страницата ни sofiaforum.bg. Всичките контакти са там, така че свързвайте се с нас. Много ще се радваме да продължим тази, а и не само тази, и други теми. And now I would like to invite you, Mary Jo and Adrian, to join me here. Thank you for coming along to Bulgaria. Thank you for sharing your experience with us. And you deserve our warmest applause. Please join me in thanking our speakers. I'm pretty sure that it's not the last time you visit us.
That's a promise.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. Сега искам специално да поканя тук Надя Обретенова, нашия прекрасен водещ, и моля за вашите аплодисменти към Надя. Специални благодарности и на нашите преводачи, които също спомогнаха за това събитие. И благодаря на всички вас за много активното участие. Отново, нека да продължим да работим заедно. Търсете ни, ние вас ще ви търсим също за следващи събития. Още веднъж много благодаря.
Благодаря. Приятна вечер на всички. И понеже е време за реклама, да ви кажа, че до вечера в новините по света и у нас може да гледате кратък репортаж от днешното събитие. Ще се радвам да откриете най-важното за вас в този репортаж.
А сега ви каним на един коктейл в съседната зала, така че да осмислим това, което мина пред нашите очи днес.
International Board. Коктейл.
Коктейл, of
course. Yeah. It's national word, yeah.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Jordan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.